come forward. All elders and all pastors to come forward, please. All elders and all pastors, come forward, please. I need to take you to the back.
Also with me. My father's house, I've been imagining. When I told my children, I go to prepare a place for you. Where I am, there you can be.
Yeah. celebrate the life of missionary Phillis Adams.
Amen.
Amen. And we certainly thank the Lord for a life well lived.
Amen.
A person who was a great example among us. And we certainly thank the Lord for her. Amen. We will call on the following persons to, amen, come and render the service, but we shall still have a shouting good time, because we're going to praise the Lord, for He is worthy to be praised. Amen. The invocation will be by Superintendent Herman W. Bell, and the Old Testament scripture will be by Pastor Thomas Hall, and the New Testament scripture by Superintendent Milton L. Hall Jr. So with the exception of the family, I'm going to please ask you to stand for the prayer, the Old and New Testament scripture in that order. God bless you.
My soul loves Jesus. Thank you because you are our God, and you're worthy of the praise, the glory, and the honor. We're here today, God, because it's our call, our duty, our love. As we come to this service today, we come, God, because we're here because we love this family. We're here because it's our Christian duty to come and to bid a saint, a sister, her farewell to the kingdom of everlasting life. We pray, God, that you would come in and have thine own way. For you are the exalted, honored guest here on this day. Let your spirit abide, the spirit to bring the comfort that we all need in times like these. Let the Holy Ghost, hallelujah, have room today. Speak to the hearts of your people that come to comfort the word of God that shall go forth in this place. But we pray for this bereaved family, that God, the wound in their heart shall be healed by the Spirit of grace, that their mind shall be covered by the God of all comforts, We thank you now for Jesus Christ and the blood that was shed for moments like this, that we might enter into the realm of eternal life to be with our Heavenly Father forever and forever. So God, receive our sister today. Hallelujah. For your glory's sake. Now bless us all. Keep us in the center of your will in our prayer today in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
Standing for our Old Testament scripture as requested, coming from the book of Ezekiel, the 37th chapter. Let's start at the 11th verse. It says, "Then he said unto me, Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. Behold, they say our bones are dry, and our hope is lost. We are cut off for our parts. Therefore prophesy and say to them, Thus saith the Lord God, Behold, O my people, I will open your graves and cause you to come up out of your graves and bring you into the land of Israel. And ye shall know that I am the Lord. And when I have opened your graves, O my people, and brought you up out of your graves, and shall put my spirit in you, and ye shall live, and I shall place you in your own land. Then shall ye know that I, the Lord, have spoken it and performed it, and saith the Lord." May the Lord have a blessing to the hearers, readers, and doers of his word.
Reading for hearings, 1 Thessalonians, the 4th chapter, beginning at the 13th verse. "But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive," hallelujah,
"yes,
"and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself,"
yes,
"shall descend from heaven,"
yes,
"with a shout,"
yes,
"with the voice of the archangel,"
all right,
"and with the trump of God, and," hallelujah, "the dead in Christ,"
yes,
"shall rise,"
yes,
"first."
Yes.
"Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up,"
yes,
"caught up,"
yes,
"together with them,"
oh, yes,
"in the clouds,"
hallelujah,
"to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we be," hallelujah,
yes,
"with the Lord."
With the Lord.
Said, "Wherefore comfort one another with these words. And I say, be not dismayed, whatever be taught."
Hallelujah.
"God will take care of
you." Hallelujah. Yes. Yes.
God bless you. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Thank you so much. Amen. At this time, amen, we will be blessed with a musical selection. Amen. By the combined choir, Evangelist Gwendolyn L. Lang.
Thank you.
put your hand together and bless the Lord. I do not believe that Bishop William Allen is in the room, but we certainly thank the Lord for God being good to us. We thank the Lord for Jesus, who shed his blood for us on the cross of Calvary. We certainly honor the presiding officer today, Bishop David Allen Hall of our headquarters jurisdiction of Tennessee. And God bless you, Bishop Hall. And we certainly honor Bishop Robert Sanders of Illinois Third Jurisdiction. And of course to my uncle, my mom, and our aunts, and the entire family, we certainly greet you in the name of the Lord. And we want you to know that, amen, we are praying for you. And then we love you very much, and we certainly appreciate the privilege of standing here as the expediter of this service. We are going to move along since Bishop William Allen is not here. We have Bishop Robert Sanders. He made a special arrangement to be here with my uncle, who is the superintendent in his district jurisdiction. So therefore, we're going to receive Bishop Robert Sanders at this time. Amen. And then following him will be Superintendent Dr. David Blakely, the host pastor of Faith Temple Church of God in Christ here in Chicago. God bless you.
Thank you, Elder Coleman. We do give deference to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And thankful for my, this is my nephew. Y'all don't know I'm at home. This is a homecoming celebration for me. And God bless Pastor Blakely, Superintendent Blakely, and all of the pastors and superintendents and administrative assistants and elders in the present. And to my own superintendent, John E. Lang. I give deference to this wonderful family who was amalgamated into our families by the pioneers of this great state of Indiana. Yes, Mother Gamble, who was driven by Claude E. Lang. You can look up and see her coming into your house at any time. She didn't call, she didn't make no, well, you could call if you had no phone. But she made no other kind of announcements that she was coming. And when we look up, here comes this big black car. And this black woman gets out, dressed black from head to toe. Mother Nancy Gamble came in and stayed as long as she wanted to. Put Mom and Daddy out of bed. And she got in it. Of course, they put us out of ours. But that's the way it was back in those days. And yes, this family here, and I grew up as brothers and sisters. There's Hazel over there, there's Gloria there, and there's Nancy sitting there, Sarah Nina sitting right there, and of course, Brother John. Brother John and Gloria taught me how to sing. The reason I could sing so good, because of that. And I'm happy to be with you. God bless you, Mother Hall. And so grateful and so thankful, not because Phillis died, but Phillis lived.
Amen.
And she was a darling and made an impression upon all of our hearts and all of our lives. And even though I got up out of my sick bed today, I was at church yesterday and I said, I'm going to go home and I'm going to go to bed and stay all day so that I can get ready for watch service on Wednesday night. And then my wife says to me, you ain't gonna stay in bed. I'm gonna try, but she reminds me that I have two funerals today. All right. two of them today. And I'm grateful for you, and should not bore your patience or belong the time. I'm here. You see I'm here, and I want to be here. God bless.
Amen.
So when I leave, don't think I'm being funny, y'all. I'm going to do the other one just like I did this one.
All right.
God bless each and every one of you. We honor God for this opportunity to be here, to be a part of such a momentous occasion. For when I think about the Lang family and the Blakely family and how it was we were together, I give honor to God, certainly to His servant, Bishop Hall and Bishop Sanders, and to all of these pastors and the family, each and every one of you. My mind went back to the days when things were the way they were. I don't know exactly what year Elder Hall, who went on to be with the Lord not too long ago, but the Halls and the Blakelys, and certainly when I think about leadership and so many things that have happened, for Elder Lang was saved right here at Faith Temple Church. My dad was saved down on the corner down there. There used to be a joint down there. And my mother and my grandmother, think about all those years back there and how it was that before my dad married my mother, he was down on that corner, and his mother, she got saved. And when I think about she got saved and her oldest child, who was my dad's older sister, they got saved, and they were telling my dad about what Elder Hall had to say. Now that's the father of Bishop Hall.
That's right.
And when they were doing what they were doing out on the street and witnessing and telling people about what had to be done, my dad's sister, she lived in Chicago, and all of those days and all of the things that happened, it comes back to me. But when my grandmother, she got saved, and she was telling her son about what was going to happen, and that the Bible said that without holiness, nobody would be saved, and you're not saved, so you're going to go to that other place except you get saved. And he said, oh, that ain't in no Bible.
Uh-huh.
So he got kind of upset about it. They didn't know where to search. So they went and asked Elder Hall, the evangelist, where was that found? And they found it, and they came back, and they were talking to him. And what happened was that they handed him the Bible, and he started to read Hebrews 12:14. Follow peace with all men and holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. While he was reading it, he said something hit him in the top of his head. And it stunned him, so he didn't know what to do. And he came to himself to say, I guess I've got to get holy. And certainly the Lord brought him, and it was not long before the Lord brought Elder Lang together. And the two families were raised right here in this neighborhood. And I thought about this. Those are back during the days, if Brother John and I were to get in trouble out there doing something, and the old folk picked up, as they call it, a strop, and they gave us a whooping.
That's right.
We got that whooping while we were out there, but when we got home, we got another whooping. So we were raised, the Blakelys and the Langs were raised together. And I thought about this. I remember when my dad used to refer to Elder, he's now Elder Superintendent John Lang. And what happened was that he asked him things, and then my dad, used to call him and I Mutt and Jeff. So whoever was the tall one, I know who was the tall one. I don't know who was Mutton, who was Jeff. But we were raised together. Elder Lang, his mother, Mother Lang was one of the most profound musicians you ever wanted to see. Anointed, one who had great power with God, and he taught us the way of holiness. And she was the piano player, and Elder John and I were piano players and organ players, and we were raised here. And I'm going to tell you this as I go to my seat. When I think of Phillis and how sweet and how nice, how wonderful she was as a young person coming up, it was one of those things I shall never ever forget her as being my younger sister spiritually. But she was one of those, and we can never ever forget how God favored her and how she grew up knowing God and wanted to tell her friends about God. And I say this to young people as I go to my seat, just keep in mind that young people can get an anointing at a young age and can begin to tell their friends about Jesus. And certainly Phillis was one of those, and I can never ever forget her. A sweet young person. And when Elder John and I had responsibility for the choirs and all those kinds of things, we had wonderful times together. And Sister Phillis and even Sister all of the family, don't let me start calling names. But it's just that when I think about the good old days and how they raised us and what they wanted us to be, it is nothing but just an equal output of the Spirit into our lives, and we began to live what we were taught. And both of us became preachers, and then both of us became pastors. Elder John is my brother and my friend, and certainly I can never, ever forget the members of the family, all of them, one by one. May God bless you and keep you is the prayer that we have for you now. God bless you.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. God bless you. We certainly are honored today to have in our midst a very good friend. And we can even style her as a family member. But the first thing I wanted to say, I'm not Elder Craig Coleman. I'm Pastor Emmanuel John. Elder Coleman was not able to be here, so therefore I'm proxying in his stead. Amen. But we are pleased to have in our midst the Honorable Mayor of the City of Gary, Mayor Karen Wilson Freeman.
Amen.
Amen. I would like to allow a space for expression. Let's say amen for our people. Just before, there is a note here that, there is a note that someone with a cream colored Kia, it's parked across the street in somebody's driveway. Your license plate number is RXN718. Please move it. Thank you.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
For he is good.
Yes, he is.
His mercy endures forever. There's a scripture that I love, and it says David, it's a psalm of David that says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continue to be in my mouth. And, you know, it's easy to bless the Lord in good times. But it's a more of a challenge when you are sad or have some bereavement. But we can bless the Lord today because this is a celebration of the life of one of God's saints. Yes. So I want to say to certainly our host pastor, Pastor David Blakely, to the bishops, Bishop David Hall, Bishop Robin Sanders, all of the members, ministers in the pulpit, and especially to Grand Lady, to Aunt Nancy, to Aunt Hazel, to Auntie Fat, to Uncle John, and to this entire family who I consider my family. I just want to say that I am honored to participate in the celebration of life of such a sweet and regal woman. And I remember I was 19, I'm 54 now, when I first met Auntie Phillis. And whenever you meet a family of somebody that you're dating, you have to figure out all the details after the service. But they size you up.
Yes, they do.
So, of course, Big Daddy was a little suspicious because I was a lawyer. In fact, he used to say, "You told us a liar." she was very tired. Already was very nice and accommodating, but I could tell she was like looking at me kind of sideways. But Auntie Phillis was always sweet and always welcome. Whether I saw her or at the house in New Edition or whether we were at her house on Clark Road, she was always sweet and nice. And I think she was that way to everybody. So it wasn't just me. But I just want to say to this family that we love you. And long after this day has come and gone, we will be here for you. And know that we are praying for you. And the thing that you can always rest in is that we all know that she is in heaven.
At this time, we will be graced with a solo by Zuri Kimbo, the grand niece, "Take Me to the King."
All right.
How do you pray?
to gain upon your glory and sing to you the song. Please take me to the King. Within the time, stop on these things.
Come on, baby.
Us a brief synopsis of what you may have to share with us in consideration of the time and the person that will come behind you. Amen. At this time, amen, the program calls for tributes, 2 minutes, by the Lang family, nieces and nephews. We have missionary Leo Alake, Lance Gregory, Mona Barnes, and Curtis Pounds, in that order. Let's say amen for them.
She showed us what it is to be a woman of God. She didn't play around. but she walked in elegancy, tall stature woman of God. And I just loved her. And I just thinking about the things that she had taught us, how to be a woman of God. Not a woman of the world, because she didn't know anything about the world, but she knew God. She knew that who had her back. And she knew that God loved her, and she knew that her family loved her, and she knew that we did everything that we could do for her. And what she did was return her love to us. So I, as her niece, her oldest niece, I loved her, and I loved her for the woman that she was. So God bless y'all, and thank you so much.
First, giving honor to God, the pastors on the roster, Bishop David Hall. I'm really hurting right now, but I'm joyful at the same time.
Yes.
I had an aunt like no other.
Yes.
I loved all of my aunts, my great aunt, because they had such a grace. They carried themselves the way that women should carry themselves. They taught us just by example of what it is to be a woman. How you should carry yourself, how you should act, and who you should be serving. And the person you should be serving is God.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
There was so much for me to say, I just thought that I better write some things down. As a little girl, I recall how I loved and adored my Aunt Phillis. We called her Aunt Phillis, but as we became women ourselves, she says, I'm not your aunt, I'm your cousin. So my cousin Phillis, she stood with such beauty and grace. I wanted to know all of her beauty secrets, from the oatmeal facial scrub to the cucumber compress that she would put on in the morning. I recall just how gentle her voice was, her angelic presence. No matter when you saw her, where you saw her, at the grocery store, going to church, she always had a beautiful, beautiful grace upon her. I was at awe because Aunt Phillis embodied everything I felt a beautiful woman should be. As I grew older, and by the grace of God, much wiser, I grew to really know my angelic Aunt Phillis for the woman God wanted all of us to know. To know not because of her flawlessly beautiful face, but flawlessly faithful to God's word. An obedient servant, righteous, saved, and filled with the Holy Ghost. Yes, very kind. A saint that edified everything God wants us to be as his disciples. From newborn babies to seniors, she prayed for everyone. I recall the many times she drove my grandfather, Reverend Claude Lang, to my home in Naperville, Illinois. They came to pray for the children, for the family, for my children, so that we too would experience the love that they had with the Lord. She would come for Christmas, for Kwanzaa, for anything that you wanted to celebrate. But when she came, she brought her oil. And when she brought her oil, that meant someone was going to be anointed that day. I say to my young cousins, who did not have the honor of knowing Aunt Phillis like we did, of going to the concerts or to church with her or just to the store, I say to you, even though you don't have Aunt Phillis like we had her, you have her in your mothers. You have her in your cousins. When you look at us, I hope that you see a piece of Aunt Phillis. She touched every soul that she ever encountered. Love her, love yourself as God loved you. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
giving honor to God that's ahead of my life. And thankful for the family and giving honor to all the great pastors and bishops that's represented here today for Auntie Phillis. It's a real good homegoing celebration. And we're going to miss our auntie. She was a magnificent woman. I talked to my cousins, to all the men. We've always looked for a woman with those virtues. Some of us have succeeded, some haven't. A lot of us come close, you know. We're going to continue to try to make it with what we got. You know, Dr. Phillis was a wonderful woman. She touched your life. You know, she comes, like Mama said, she comes into your presence and changes the whole dynamic and spirit of your home. And we had her for, you know, for ourselves. I know each one of us, I don't know how she had the time. She was special. She'd come, and you felt like you was the only one. She took me to concerts. She prayed with me. She showed me how to pray. Got my Holy Spirit stirred up. It's been stirred up ever since.
Amen.
You know,
amen.
I can stray so far, and they'd be like, no, don't do that. Dr. Phillis, Big Daddy, Mama Deb, all my aunts and uncles and family, you're just strong like that. You can call somebody, they'll stop you in your tracks and say, you weren't raised like that.
Right.
Not a whole bunch of speeches or anything like that. They just say, you weren't raised like that.
So all right. All
you know
right.
How to get on the good track. But I'm thankful that she was in our lives, and we'll miss her, that's no doubt. I'll think about her all the time and how she's meant to me. I just want to say that glory to God, Auntie Phillis. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Great job, Auntie Phillis. I want to say thank you for coming out and supporting my family. I love my family. I love my Auntie Phillis. But what y'all don't know is the part about it we call the Auntie Phil call.
Yes.
Okay, that's the part that I don't know. Auntie Phil goes to take us shopping. But I also go to Papa's. See, she, they don't tell you that part. They don't tell you. But I watched my auntie work with my grandfather. I watched my auntie dedicate her life to her family. And I want my auntie to know that we dedicate our life to family. Mm, yeah. I want my family to know that I love y'all. I'll always be there for you. So even though our heart is troubled,
yeah,
she's always with us.
Yes.
Thank you.
Amen. Well, there is something missing that we have in the homegoing of a sanctified woman, and we wouldn't have church. Now, we wouldn't want to come thus far and still don't have church. Is that right? So therefore, right here, I think there is time for a congregational song. Amen. Let's say amen for Evangelist Gwendolyn.
Let me see one more time. He was so precious that the brothers weren't even jealous of him. They were jealous of Joseph and tried to harm him. But I thank God for Phillis. And all of us loved her. Amen. She was the only one of my sisters that could call me boy. Grown as I was. Older as I was of her, but she would call me, boy, what you talking about? She was spiritually older than all of us. Although we were raised, as Brother David was telling you, in Christian homes, but some of that just went past our ears. Amen. She never knew about the nightclub. But some of us did. Amen. She never knew about staying out all night and wait till the sun come up. Now it's time to go home. But some of us did. But she was an example, a paragon of faith. She took her walk with the Lord seriously early in her life. And because of that, she was able to stand so that we could see the way to the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And she followed the threefold duty of mankind. She followed that process that enables one to come to God just as I am. She was able, as Psalms 116 and 13 tells us, she had the appropriation, she had the formation and the donation. In her appropriation out of Psalms 116 and 13 says, I will take the cup of the Lord of salvation. Yes, I will. And call upon his name. She did that early in her life. And because she did that, we had a young example to follow. Just as I am. Without one plea, the song says, she did that. And when you look at the word of God that tells us about formation, you can become saved and sanctified
But you need to be filled. You need to be dressed up with salvation that comes through the Word of God. Comes through the Word of God. And we thank God for how she went through that process. And in the formation, she was educated academically, and she was developing self-skills when she taught herself how to play the piano like her mama. It surprised me, but I was so pleased that there was somebody else in the family that could play an instrument beside myself. Amen. None of my children could do it. But she went back to take on some of the skill that her mother did. Not only that, but she learned in her formation how to minister. She got her missionary license, became a missionary. And I think about her, and I see pictures of her and Elder Brother Parkman when they would do the helps ministry and visit the sick. And not only that, but she learned spiritually in her formation how to pray.
Yes. Amen.
That prayer life was one of a solid foundation. But not only that, as I get ready to take my seat, but she learned the donation. Freely you have received, now you must freely give. And she was ready to give you what the Lord had given her. She was ready to give you the word of the Lord. And like my daddy, I don't care what kind of conversation you would get into him, you'd get it about fishing, get it about cars, get it about the president, he's gonna take you to the Bible. Amen. She was doing the same thing. And I went to see her on those last days, and I could tell that she was on her transition. The Spirit of the Lord. See, ministers, you know, when you go to pray for folk, your discernment begins to work. And it saddened me, but for her to leave and go to glory is a blessing. Yes. Said, bless the death of the saints.
Yes.
The sight of the Lord God enjoys them coming to him. God bless. I'd be remiss if I didn't just sing a verse or two at my sister's home. I know the Lord. I know the Lord. I know the Lord has laid his hand.
Thank you.
would like to take this moment to acknowledge our oldest parent in the room, Mother Julia Ruth Hall. God bless you, Mother Hall. Now, I'm going to ask everybody that will come thereafter to please adhere to the 2 minutes time limit. Now, if I do stand this time, as much as I'm enjoying what you're saying, I'm not encouraging you to keep on talking. That means that when I stand, it is time for you to just bring it to a close. Amen. Amen. At this time, amen, you are following the program, let us say amen.
I too would be remiss if I didn't share these things. I missed my spot, but I'm going to share this with you all. Phillis is a golden friend of ours. We went to Columbus School, elementary school, 66 years ago. That's when I met her. I want everyone in here to know that we love Phillis, and Phillis loved us. Yes. And she shared the Lord with us all of our lives. We, the class of 1961 of Roosevelt High School, and the 1948 kindergarten class of Columbus School, wish to convey our heartfelt sympathies to her family, church members, and friends. All who knew her recognized her as the epitome of the virtuous woman. She was a gracious, wise, and dignified woman who had a special relationship with the Lord and did not mind sharing her faith with anyone who would listen. She will forever remain in our memories and our hearts. Rest on our dear friend, Phillis. Now, anybody from 1961 or 1948, I would like for you to stand, and you guys can see what golden friends are. Golden friends. Very few people can claim that. We have been friends all through our lives. Rest on, dear friend. But they that hope in the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall take wings as eagles. They shall walk and not faint. Isaiah 40:31. At this time, the Lang family continues with grandnephews.
I'm gonna go way back when my auntie got married to Irvin Adams. I was just a little jealous because I wanted to know who was getting her beautiful love. And then after he passed, she became a nun because none of the others was good enough. I stand blessed here because the seeds of faith and the seeds of my destiny and righteousness have been planted, and the grounds have been tilled, nourished, and the harvests have been pulled and planted, and harvest pulled and planted again. It's harvest time. That all of these seeds, I've been blessed to have just the strength of God to carry me to this very moment. And one more thing. I'ma learn how to sing like that too.
I forgot what I was going to say.
That's all right. That's all right.
I gonna talk about my sister Phillis, about something that she did, and I just glorified her. I had to put the Lord in front, but I kept Phillis beside me, side by side. Phillis would talk to me, and when I got sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost, she just was grinning all day, grinning. She was glad that I had learned to do right. And I tell you, she talked with Mama, talked with me, and my daddy one day called, seen me coming down the street, and he said, "Now he said, what you doing with that on you got on?" I said, "Well, I went to see Phillis," and she came to the door and she said, "Daddy, I told her the same thing you told her." She said, "She need to be saved. She need to go in there and change her pants. She looked like a man going down the street."
Glory to God.
So I got rid of that and really got Christ in my life. So,
grandnephews, amen. I just love my auntie, and I just want to say things that come to my memory. When I always saw her, I always thought of her as royalty and a princess in a family.
Amen.
When I look out over the audience, I just see the epitome of her and all of you all. She's a beautiful black woman. I thank God for all of you all in my family. I'm just a blessing, you know, worth more than silver and gold. I can remember the times when my auntie used to come over and pick me and my brother up and take us out to the museum and have fun. And she'd also come and pick us up and take us to Bishop Goldsberry Church with her. And she was the prettiest woman I'd see shouting in church. I don't know how she stayed in the hills and kept that hat on, but she still got her praise on. And so I just, you know, it was a good example, you know, that she had for us. I can remember the times when we go to Big Daddy's house for a prayer for the family on Saturday mornings. And out of everybody praying, she was the one I remember always start off speaking in her heavenly language.
All right.
And I knew when she did that, we was going to be there forever. I was going to miss wrestling. But I also knew that through her prayers, those angels were kept around, not just me, but around our entire family. Because she was like Daniel. She had a prayer life. And I witnessed that. I also remember the times when she would call me up on a Saturday morning and ask me to go out with her just to hand out tracts to people in the street. You know, so she definitely had a missionary mindset, as well as she was a missionary even in her own family. And those are the things I'll remember about her. I just want to share with the family and just to let you know the heritage, you know, that we have in our family, the legacy that she kept on. And I would encourage all of our other younger family members that if you don't know the legacy, here it is right here. Call them on the phone sometime and just talk to them. And just listen. You know, I learned so much from Big Daddy, from my aunts, and from Aunt Phillis, but I'm just keeping my mouth shut and my ears open, and I let them pour all that wealth into me. You know, and that's one thing nobody will ever be able to take from me, and it's my endeavor to try to pass that down to the generations, even through video and photos and things of that nature, but I just thank God for her and for my family.
There's just a few words that I remember from when she used to come down to our house in Naperville, Illinois. She used to bless me and my brother. And when we moved, she blessed us for the travel. A beautiful smile, encouraging words every time I saw her, that's my great aunt Phillis. Patient with everyone, never an angry word to say, not one. She followed God's calling on her life. She served God by serving others, never complaining, never faltering or wavering. She showed this in the way that she took care of Mama Dear and Big Daddy and many others. A kind, spiritual, and very beautiful lady. That's my great aunt Phillis. Yeah.
Now, the operative word in the next item on the program is acknowledgement. Acknowledgement of cards, resolutions, and condolences. And so please acknowledge them at this time. Thank you. And then after that, the obituary shall be read by Aunt Serenade.
The family would like to acknowledge all cards and condolences. Third Ecclesiastical Jurisdiction of Illinois, Church of God in Christ. And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth. Yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow them. Revelations 14 and 13. Okay. And this is from Bishop Robert R. Sanders, Jurisdictional Prelate, Dr. Marilyn Cross, Jurisdictional Supervisor of Women, Superintendent Richard E. Patterson, Senior Executive Jurisdictionary Secretary, Assistant Helen Helms, Assistant Jurisdictionary Secretary. I'm here to condolence from Honorable Sonia A. Morris, Judge of Chicago, Indiana. Condolence from Pastor Dr. David Blakely from Faith Temple Church of God in Christ in East Chicago, Indiana. Condolence from True Vine Church of God in Christ, Pastor Lonnie Hogan and First Lady Deborah Hogan, East Chicago, Indiana. Resolution from Antioch Missionary Baptist Church, Pastor Reverend Justin Kidd from East Chicago, Indiana. Condolence from River of Life Ministries, Pastor Anthony Mayo of Gary, Indiana. And a condolence from Grace Memorial Institution of Church of God in Christ, Pastor Elder Benson L. Hall from Kokomo, Indiana. Thank you. Amen.
Because Phillis lived, her family, her church, her community, and the world are all better. My sister, missionary Phillis Earlene Yvonne Lang Adams, a God-fearing Christian woman of elegance and substance. Phillis Earlene Yvonne made her entrance on June 16, 1973, into a world ravaged by the World War II, a world full of uncertainty and warfare. Nonetheless, she was welcomed by her mom, Hazel Watson Lang, an accomplished church pianist for 28 years, District Sunshine Band leader and scribe. And her dad, Reverend Claude Lang, a Pentecostal evangelist and apostle of our time, who worked with State Mother Nancy Gamble to help birth and lay the foundation for numerous Pentecostal churches in Illinois, Indiana, and Michigan. And he devoted more than 80 years of his life to evangelistic ministry. She is also the descendant of Frederick and Annabelle Lang of Langsdale, Mississippi, and Wilson and Ada Watson of Harvey, Illinois. And also excited about her arrival were her sisters, Nancy, Gloria, Hazel, and Serenetta, and her brother John. She was the baby of the family, and she was adorable. She was not fretful, not a fretful baby at all, and she loved being held. She was cuddled, pampered,
and carried about by her older siblings. When she wasn't skipping through the house or tagging behind her siblings, she was hanging around her mom, her favorite place to be. She lived in a close-knit family. Grounded in a Christian faith, she accepted Christ as her Savior as a child and never wavered from her commitment and service to God. She was nurtured and grew spiritually at Faith Temple Church of God in Christ, formerly Block Avenue Church of God in Christ, under the pastorship and leadership of Bishop William O. Blakely. She participated in Sunshine Band, Sunday School, Purity Class, and numerous other activities at the church. Faith Temple was her home church, and she loved the saints and the praise and the worship services. While dining in the home of her friends, Louise and Charles McGill, she was introduced to Jesse Jackson and his best friend, Jesse Dixon, and his best friend, Irvin Adams of Chicago. Shortly thereafter, Phillis and Irvin started dating and married in a grand church wedding ceremony the next year on September 16, 1972. Phillis joined Irvin in worship at Faith Temple Church of God in Christ in Chicago, Illinois, and served faithfully under the leadership of the late Bishop Goldberry and later his successor, Superintendent William Allen. A year later, in the fall of 1973, Irvin passed away after a short illness. After her husband's passing, Phillis' faith and strong family ties sustained her during her bereavement. She became a wonderful aunt and role model to her nieces and nephews, taking the younger nieces, Rachel and Abrana, on vacations to cultural events and to church. An excellent wedding planner, she used her skills to help older nieces and nephews and siblings and friends with their wedding preparations. She took delight in sharing God's word and providing Christian instruction to both nieces and nephews. An excellent seamstress, Phillis wore exquisite custom-made apparel that had the perfect fit and style for a youthful Christian woman. She was a devoted caregiver for numerous years to her mother, who suffered from rheumatoid arthritis, until her passing after 60 years of marriage on August 2, 1992, at the age of 85. She also was a devoted caregiver to her father and aided him and her stepmothers, both of whom preceded him in death. She continued to care for her dad until his passing on March 11, 2009. At the age of 107. Phillis was a graduate of East Chicago Roosevelt High School in the June of 1961. She received a Bachelor of English and History degree from St. Joseph's Catholic College on April 19, 1979, and went on to complete advanced studies at Moody Bible Institute, a Christian institution of higher education in Chicago, Illinois. She often worked as a substitute teacher for the East Chicago public school system, but her primary employment was with Middleton, your former Youngstown Sheep and Tube Company, until she retired after 40 years. During her adult life, her love of music led her to take piano lessons, and her love of sharing God's word guided her into evangelistic work. She became a licensed evangelist missionary of the Church of God in Christ and continued to evangelize and share God's word until stricken by early onset Alzheimer's. Phillis served God until she made her transition to her heavenly home at 8:45 p.m. Saturday, December the 20th, where she will be united with her mom, her dad, and Urban. Known to her family and friends as the authentic symbol of Christian woman, of elegance, substance, kind-heartedness, and love, as she was the love of our life. Phillis leaves to mourn and to cherish her memory. Five siblings: Missionary Nancy Harvey, Samuels of Hammond, Indiana; Superintendent John and Gwendolyn Lang of Creek, Illinois; Gloria Gravy of Hammond, Indiana;
Hazel Mace of Gary, Indiana, and me, Claudia Serenetta, and Dr. Lorenzo Pitts of Sandy Springs, Georgia. 37 nieces and nephews, 65 grandnieces and nephews, 34 plus great grandnieces and nephews, brother-in-laws, Al and Henry Adams, and Georgia of Chicago, Illinois, and Cynthia, a sister-in-law. Two aunts, Mother Julia Ruth Hall of Kokomo, Indiana, and Aunt Mother LaJune Watson, who's like 96 or 7, of West Palm Beach, Florida, and numerous first and second cousins, and you, her friends. The Lang siblings are eternally grateful to Phillis's long-serving and tireless caregivers who spent countless nights and days at her bedside. I am truly humbled by their demonstration of compassion and service. Ms. Rachel Gregory, McLennan, yes. Greta Gregory, yes. Donna Gregory, yes. And Arana Pons. Our appreciation is also extended to our family members and friends who assisted them, and the doctors and nurses, staff at Methodist Hospital of Maryville, Indiana, and the local health care and nursing facilities that care for our sisters Phillis with respect and humanity. Because Phillis lived, we are all better.
She opened her mouth with wisdom, and on her tongue was the law of kindness. That was Aunt Phillis to me. At this time, we would like to acknowledge all the superintendents that are here in attendance. Would you please stand and let the family see you? All the superintendents, would you please stand? The superintendents, we would like to acknowledge you. Because in the interest of time, we will not be able to, In the interest of time, we will not be able to hear expressions from them, so we would like for all pastors and elders to please stand at this time. And ministers, God bless you. We thank the Lord for all the missionaries that are here in attendance. Would you also stand? Let us acknowledge you. The church family is here. Thank God for you. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Oh, I'm sorry. Mother Bush is here, the state supervisor of Indiana, second, third jurisdiction. God bless you. Amen. I didn't see you there. At this time, amen, we will be graced with a selection or solo from Evangelist Gwendolyn Lang. And after she shall have sung, amen, we will ask, with the exception of the family, amen, so that you can rise and receive the eulogies of the hour, Bishop David Allen Hall. Let's say amen.